Hi, my name is Lina Chaya, and I'm a member of St. Paul's Episcopal Church in Burlingame. Whether today is your first time, or if you've been a longtime church member, I'd like to welcome you to join us in this morning online service. Also, check out our church website for news, updates, music, and other helpful resources. Thanks again for joining us, and I hope to be able to worship with you in person sometime soon. Have a nice day.
Blessed be God, most holy, glorious, and undivided Trinity. God be with you. Let us pray. O God, the protector of all who trust in you, without whom nothing is strong, nothing is holy, increase and multiply upon us your mercy, that with you as our ruler and guide, we may so pass through things temporal, that we lose not the things eternal. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
At Gibeon, the Lord appeared to Solomon in a dream by night, and God said, "Ask what I should give you." And Solomon said, "You have shown great and steadfast love to your servant, my father David, because he walked before you in faithfulness and righteousness and in uprightness of heart toward you. And you have kept for him this great and steadfast love and have given him a son to sit on the throne today. And now, O Lord, my God, you have made your servant king in place of my father David. Although I am only a little child, I do not know how to go out or come in. And your servant is in the midst of the people whom you have chosen, a great people, so numerous, they cannot be numbered or counted. Give your servant therefore, an understanding mind to govern your people, able to discern between good and evil. For who can govern this great people? It pleased the Lord that Solomon had asked this. God said to him, because you have asked this and have not asked for yourself long life or riches or for the life of your enemies, that you have asked for yourself understanding to discern what is right. I now do according to your word. I give you a wise and discerning mind. No one like you has been before you, and no one like you shall arise after you.
Your decrees are wonderful. Therefore, I obey them with all my heart. When your word goes forth, it gives light. It gives understanding to the simple. I open my mouth and pant. I long for your commandments. Turn to me in mercy, as you always do to those who love your name. Steady my footsteps in your word. Let no iniquity have dominion over me. Rescue me from those who oppress me, and I will keep your commandments. Let your countenance shine upon your servant, and teach me your statutes. My eyes shed streams of tears, because people do not keep your law.
A reading from the Gospel according to Matthew. Jesus put before the crowds another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed that someone took and sowed into his field. It is the smallest of all seeds, but when it has grown, it is the greatest of shrubs and becomes a tree, so that the birds of the air come and make nests in its branches. He told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like yeast that a woman took and mixed in with 3 measures of flour until all of it was leavened. The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which someone found and hid. Then in his joy, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls. On finding one pearl of great value, he went and sold all that he had and bought it. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was thrown into the sea and caught fish of every kind. When it was full, they drew it ashore, sat down, and put the good into baskets, but threw out the bad. So it will be at the end of age. The angels will come out and separate the evil from the righteous and throw them into the furnace of fire, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Have you understood all this? They answered yes. And he said to them, therefore, every scribe who has been trained for the kingdom of heaven is like the master of a household who brings out of his treasure what is new and what is old.
Would you pray with me? Gracious and loving God, help us to understand and celebrate your dream for the world, to be transformed in Jesus' love, and to use our gifts to make a difference for others. Amen. So a few days from now is going to be the feast day of Saint Ignatius of Loyola. He's kind of like almost my favorite saint. So July 31st this year also happens to be a big day in my family because we are expecting, and that is actually the due date. So when I heard officially the first time, you know, from the technician that our due date was the 31st, I was beyond myself. The day of my favorite saint, and inspiring this newborn child with the spirit of contemplation, the spirit of tenacity, the spirit of Spanish zeal. I was pretty pumped. But to continue to tell you about St. Ignatius, for those of you who don't know, we call his spirituality Ignatian after his name, Ignatius. His original name was Inigo, and he was a guy about my height, about 5'2", and he was fierce. He wanted to fight, so he used a lot of the military language of his time to describe his relationship with God. So he was pretty extreme. For the greater glory of God. And you see it in Jesuit schools now. AMDG, Ad Majorem De Gloriam. For the greater glory of God. That everything we do is for the greater glory of God. So if you were to take your to-do list, for example, I'm supposed to do laundry, I'm supposed to go to the grocery store, I'm supposed to connect with so-and-so, oh, I owe so-and-so an email or a text message or maybe a phone call, I would say a great spiritual practice that I've been doing myself is adding AMDG, Ad Majorem De Gloriam, or for the greater glory of God, to the end of every sentence. So I got to do laundry for the greater glory of God. I got to call somebody for the greater glory of God. I got to whatever it is. And that has helped me to prioritize a few things in my life, whether or not that's just today or just over the course of the week or over the course of the month or how I devote my life, how I prioritize my career, all those different things. So if it's helpful for you, great. I thought it would be fitting to talk about that this Sunday with the passage in Matthew. So the passage in Matthew continues to teach the disciples. So I have to laugh because it's Jesus trying to teach the disciples what the kingdom of heaven, as Matthew says, would be. So he uses a series of similes. And for those of you who are teachers, particularly English ones, it just strikes me to be a pretty funny situation. I don't know if it's intended to be funny, but Ignatian spirituality, or Ignatius, tells me to pray and compose the place. Compose the place in my brain and my heart so that I am truly there and can hear the word of God spoken in its delivery. So in my hearing, as an educator, I hear Jesus say, "All right, everybody, the kingdom of God is like a mustard seed. You know how small those little mustard seeds are, but then they grow up into a beautiful tree or a beautiful bush, and all these different birds can perch on it?" And the guys are like, "Okay." And he goes, "Okay, the kingdom of God is like leaven, you know, so you put yeast in flour, you need a whole bunch of flour, but just a tiny bit of yeast, and that'll give bread leaven." And again, the guys are like, "Okay," right? So he goes through a series of different similes to try to describe the mystery, the complicated mystery of what the kingdom of heaven in Matthew's gospel means. Little caveat, I'm gonna get to this in a second, but the kingdom of heaven is not a place, not in Matthew. It's not a place. It's not like, oh, what does heaven look like? It's not necessarily a physical place, but it is a state of being, right? So the kingdom of heaven, also referred to the reign of God or the rule of God, or again, if God was in charge, I would like to say, if God was in charge, what would the world look like? And originally God was, and the challenge is God is. God is in charge. What was God's intention? Or what would, Ignatius would say, what would God's desire for the world be? We say, what is God's dream for us? Martin Luther King, Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. liked to use the language of the beloved community. And as lovely as that language is, I want to be very careful to underscore that it comes from a particular time in history where during the Civil Rights Movement, people were choosing to act nonviolently against their oppressors. So Martin Luther King takes this language from Josiah Royce and continues to use it in this act of defiance against unjust laws. So he says that there are three evils. So for us to adopt this language, and I have to say it's still hard for me to, and I want to, and I've committed for the greater glory of God, I'm committed to this language of the beloved community, contributing to the beloved community. So it isn't just, I dream that the kingdom of God or the kingdom of heaven or the rule of God is just peaceful. All these things that are contrary and should be fighting, you know, just are at peace. Well, that's really, really nice and pleasant. And we know that life is real. And I think Jesus knew that too for his disciples, because he said, the kingdom of heaven is also like finding hidden treasure. The merchant goes back, sells all his stuff to buy that property. Now, I wasn't there when Jesus was around physically, but I hear that you can't really do that. In American culture, we would probably say, finders, keepers. No, we can't really do that. That's not necessarily how society was structured. So the fact that that person came upon this treasure and then decided to bury it again and then buy the property, in all honesty, this moment of joy, like finding this treasure, like great. Like the kingdom of heaven is like joyful and there's a surprise. There may actually be a consequence to obtaining that. And I think Jesus knew that, which is why he used that simile. Or like Pastor Pete said last week, the wheat and the weeds grow together. Like again, there are consequences to this nature, to God's nature, to God's way. And in the end, it'll be sorted out. So the consequences in the beloved community or believing in this language or fortifying your life to what Dr. Martin Luther King used, the beloved community, the image of this beloved community, be loved and love, right? Was that there are three evils that are also in existence in this world. Poverty is an evil. Racism is an evil. And lastly, militarism is an evil. There's so much to unpack with those three tenets, but the beloved community, in order for us to develop and build and contribute to a beloved community, the three obstacles of evil are poverty, racism, and militarism. And we combat all of those with nonviolent tactics, with peaceful tactics. If we want justice, we must do so with the very actions of peace. So I wonder, this is what Ignatius would say, I wonder, what is my desire for the world? Okay, so for the greater glory of God, everything that I do, everything that I see, everything that is the kingdom of heaven, how can I imagine, how can I dream this? What do I want to dream to be made manifest in this world? Oh, give me a second. There is a wonderful Baldwin quote. So James Baldwin wrote this quote that I was reflecting on this past week. And it goes something like this. The interior life is real. The interior life is real, and the intangible dreams of a person may have a tangible effect on the world. I feel my impression with Ignatian spirituality is just that, dream it, because whatever your dream is, whatever that conviction is, will lead to just action for building the kingdom of God, in Ignatius's language. So Martin Luther King does the same thing, right? So here's this beloved community. Here are these real obstacles. The beloved community is not something later. The beloved community could be happening right now. What we need to do is combat, which again is so restrictive, it's militaristic language, I don't mean to use it, but that's what I have, is to stand firmly against interrupting, resisting that other evil that is entering into our lives, into our society. So now, what would I say? How would I complete the sentence? The kingdom of heaven is like. What would you say? The beloved community is like. What would you say? perhaps even taking a moment this week, writing it down, praying with Jesus in that place where he was teaching his disciples, and then after your prayer period, writing it down, finishing the sentence, the kingdom of heaven is like, maybe 5 times you do that. Maybe you share it with one other person, or 2 or 3. Maybe you email me or call me and you share it with me and you say the kingdom of heaven is like, if you're willing to take on the language of the beloved community is like. I have 2 images that got me this week that I can say. The beloved community is like the wall of moms. There is a long tradition of this wall of moms that we are now seeing in recent terms, right? In the most current form in Portland, how women in helmets and in shirts that say, I was summoned when George Floyd called out for his mama. You know, you just Google it. There are tons of these images, particularly of white women going out, although it is mixed, right? But going out and holding one another arm in arm and saying no to the militarism that is happening in Portland. Another image that I have, Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez. Excuse me if I think I got her name right. But it's AOC. I like her. I call her AOC, right? Everyone calls her AOC. She's a Democratic representative out of New York, and she spoke truth to power. And we know this. We see this. We talk about it. People encourage us to do it. But seeing it on the House floor, one of 79 ever women of color to be legislating in our United States, out of the 11,000 people ever to be legislators, speaking truth to power, saying that the language used to describe her, because she had a different perspective from someone that she was also legislating with, was not acceptable. Again, not vicious, not hard, not anything, and still fighting, still standing up for herself, for other women, other girls, her family, standing up for, as she says, the woman that her parents raised her to be. So if you haven't caught it, again, Google it, AOC, and it's really, really powerful. So those are the 2 moments where I can say the beloved community is like people standing up for themselves and for one another against an ism. In this case, AOC's was sexism. The beloved community is like the wall of moms, summoned because a man had been brutally murdered on TV, captured on TV, summoned because he called out for his mama, and that there's this universal feel of what it means to be mama or in relationship with one another. So my friends, take it for whatever it's worth. If AMDG stuck with you, if the beloved community sticks with you and challenges you, whatever you do, just sit at the feet of Jesus this week and listen to him as he shares with you what the kingdom of heaven is like.
Oh. we bring our prayers to our God, who is full of compassion, mercy, and love. We pray for all people who are inspired by Jesus, his teachings, and his own life. May we continue to build the beloved community where goodness, wisdom, forgiveness, and mercy become an antidote for false witness, arrogance, division, and argumentative stances. God of every age, strengthen our efforts to witness to your good news. We follow the teachings of Jesus in the hope that these lessons will transform us. May we receive instruction with humility and be encouraged to practice our new findings. May our efforts to act out of love overcome the fear that paralyzes us so that all of us, our families, and our neighbors may allow for the tender caring of those oppressed and those needing protection and defending from undue harm. God, our teacher, strengthen our capacity to love others. Our world needs the powerful presence and guiding force of your Spirit in these troubled times. Move the heart of every person that we may attend to the poor, the unemployed, and the oppressed, and all who are in need. Help us to affirm one another and to build up and embrace the gifts among us. God of compassion, we remember those who are working hard to uphold justice. There are many who are ill and in need of healing. Especially we remember today Hiroyuki Momori, Michelle Blair, Carol Schaefer, Nan Kasoulos, Tom Bryce, Renee and Bernard Kimi, Wally Klobuchar, Mimi Butler, Ray Manoa, Dylan, Jim Prescott, the Murdaugh family, especially Charlotte, and those you would like to add at this time. Please add your own prayers for those who are ill. Spirit of the living God, heal all who are in pain and sorrow. We call to mind all who are suffering emotionally and mentally with the struggle of living and working in a pandemic. Give them courage and patience. Remind them to be gentle and kind with themselves, and strengthen them with the confidence of knowing they are held in your hands. Spirit of the living God, strengthen us for these days. We remember the Black communities, beloved children of God, who have for decades suffered and cried out against injustice and police brutality. Let us all rise together, honoring Black dignity and Black citizenship. Spirit of the living God, give us wisdom and the will to respond to injustice. We remember those who have died from our own community. We remember especially those who have died from the recent and long-standing pandemics, including COVID-19, systemic racism, and climate change. Additionally, we pray for the loss of Congressman John Lewis and the Reverend C.T. Vivian, two civil rights greats who drew up upon their faith as they pushed for equality for Black Americans. Please add the names of those you remember this day. Receive them into the peace of your presence and comfort all who have lost loved ones, that they may know your consolation and hope. Lord, in your mercy, give us the hope to work for your beloved community together. In the effortless trust of the Triune God, lift our voices in our common humanity to pray the words that Jesus taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.
And may Almighty God continue to bless all of us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Alleluia, alleluia. Let us go forth now in the power of the Spirit.
Thank you.